Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter, Jr. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English.
On today's program, you will hear reports from Jill Robbins and Brian Lynn. Later, Mario Ritter Jr. presents this week's Education Report. We close the show with the lesson of the day from Faith Perlow and Andrew Smith. But first,
in the Japanese village of Kamimomi, a small group of farmers began gathering their rice in extreme heat, 2 weeks earlier than usual. Kamimomi is in Japan's western Okayama prefecture. The area is called the Land of Sunshine because of its good weather. But farmers working in the mountainside rice fields say climate change is hurting the harvest of rice. Joji Terasaka farms in Okayama. He said last year a hot period dried up the rice. He added, "I am worried about that this year because it will be just as hot." This year, Japan had its hottest July on record. The Japan Weather Agency said temperatures were 2.16 degrees Celsius higher than average. Worldwide, there has been a 1.2 degrees Celsius rise in average temperature since 1850. Scientists agreed that warming needs to be limited to 1.5 degrees Celsius to prevent the worst effects of climate change. Last year, Japan had a poor rice harvest nationwide because of unusually hot weather. Officials say the drop in harvest in Japan was partly responsible for a shortage of rice this summer. The low supply of rice in markets forced sellers to limit each buyer to one rice bag. Yuji Masutomi is a researcher at the National Institute for Environmental Studies in Tsukuba, north of Tokyo. He said, "Perhaps people think that an increase of 1 degree Celsius in average temperature isn't much, but it's quite a big change for plants and crops." Masutomi said, "The rising temperatures also hurt the quality of the grain. Last year, the farming ministry noted that at least 1/5 of rice farms have reported a drop in quality from rising temperatures. Not only is the appearance not good, people say the taste drops too," Masutomi said. Another problem the farmers in Kamimomi face is working under high heat. The average age of agricultural workers in Japan is nearly 69, among the oldest in the world. Older people are especially likely to suffer from the heat. For half of the year, farmers work in the heat to produce rice. To deal with climate change, the government is urging the use of heat-resistant varieties of rice. One strain, developed by a research center near Tokyo, is called Sai no Kizuna. Naoto Ohoka manages rice breeding at Saitama's Agricultural Technology Research Center. Ohoka said, "Last year and this year have been extremely hot, but even in those conditions, Sai no Kizuna maintained a certain level of quality." Sai no Kizuna was developed in 2012 to better survive high heat, wind, and certain pests and diseases. Masutomi recommends that similar varieties of rice should be introduced across Japan by the 2040s. But it can take up to 10 years to develop a new strain. After it is approved for the market, Farmers must then decide to grow it. The most widely grown strain of rice is Koshihikari, which does not do well in high heat. Even so, older farmers have not always been willing to change to other varieties. Farming Ministry data show that heat-resistant varieties grow in only around 15% of Japanese rice fields. I'm Jill Robbins.
South Korean researchers have developed a drone designed to stay level when transporting goods over many kinds of surfaces. A team at Seoul National University of Science and Technology built a prototype or test model of the drone. The team recently demonstrated the aircraft for reporters from Reuters. The prototype has a transport carrier attached to a drone structure. It is supported by several propellers and rotors that control its height, speed, and direction in the air. The aircraft has a handle workers can push to guide it where it needs to go. Members of the development team showed how the drone can keep itself level while floating, even when transporting goods up or down stairs. Leaders of the research say the drone is programmed to predict human actions for effective interactions. Lee Sung-ja is a professor of mechanical system design engineering at Seoul National University of Science and Technology. He was a leader of the project. The research results appeared in a study in IEEE Robotics and Automation Letters. The publication is part of the Institute of Electrical and Electronics Engineers, based in New York. Lee told Reuters tests of the drone showed it could transport objects up to 3 kilograms. He admitted this weight restriction likely limits the drone's use cases for many businesses. But he noted that the transporter's design and operating equipment could be used to create a series of other kinds of drone vehicles. Lee said one example would be to use the transporter to carry sensitive or breakable materials. The technology could also be used to develop flying taxis to transport humans, he added. When used in a flying taxi, Lee said the drones could be used to change batteries while still flying in the air, instead of having to return to a ground station for recharging. In general, experts say drones with multiple propellers are easier to control and move in many different settings. But they are also slower and cannot travel as far on a battery charge. Drones with multiple rotors have already been used to transport small amounts of goods, food, and medical supplies. But experts say it is difficult to widely expand use of such drones for commercial purposes. This is because such activities would require larger batteries a smaller aircraft could not support. I'm Brian Lynn.
The Leading Men Fellowship trains young black and Latino men to become early literacy teachers in preschool classrooms across the United States. The program aims to deal with several problems at the same time. First, officials say there is a shortage of educators for preschoolers. Another problem is there are few Black and Latino male teachers. And there are many problems that boys face in schools because of their race and sex. Ivan Douglas is with the Literacy Lab based in Washington, D.C. It is a nonprofit group that operates the Leading Men Fellowship, which started in 2016. Douglas said, "We're not only affecting change in the classroom with these school students, but we're also developing these young future educators." One of the fellows in the program is Devontez Johnson. He is 19 years old and is currently gaining experience in a preschool at Dorothy I. Heights Elementary in Baltimore, Maryland. Fellows like Johnson are recruited after they finish high school. After a summer of intensive training, they go to work in school, earning between $16.50 and $18 an hour. Johnson is unusual. He is a former high school offensive lineman in American football. It is a position held by the biggest players on the team. Some parents say he looks out of place in a classroom. Federal government information says that less than 1% of elementary and early education school teachers are Black men. Johnson said that is part of the reason he wanted to teach preschoolers. "I really thought it was a great opportunity, because I know if I saw someone like me, you know, in pre-K, I'd be pretty excited," Johnson said. The Associated Press, AP, recently reported on the Leading Men Fellowship. The AP says there is growing evidence that Black teachers can help Black students, especially boys. For example, boys are more likely than girls to be expelled from school. Some people are saying that having teachers of the same race is important for young Americans. The AP says there is research showing Black students who have at least one Black teacher are more likely to graduate from high school and less likely to get suspended or expelled. The AP says research suggests that training found at historically Black colleges might be part of developing an effective teacher. A recent study of elementary school students in North Carolina, for example, said Black students performed better in math when taught by a teacher trained at an HBCU, or a historically Black college or university. Nicholas Papa George is an economist at Johns Hopkins University in Baltimore. He said his research shows that Black teachers have higher expectations of Black students than non-Black teachers. His research also suggests that Black students who have a Black teacher are less likely to drop out of high school and more likely to attend college. Leading Men Fellow Johnson has found that singing and dancing are a big part of preschool education. He has been told that children learn best through repetition and when they can link information with movements and music. Bridget Jeffries has Johnson working in her preschool classroom. She said she has been watching Johnson grow more confident with her students. It was so beautiful because usually you don't see men really get down to the child level, Jeffries said. She said the children see him as a big kid. Johnson is also studying political science at the University of Maryland Global Campus. He hopes to go into politics, but at this time, his fellow teachers want him to stick with teaching. On a recent October day, Johnson worked individually with students to help them write their names. During free play time, he helped a student who was making an impression of a leaf on paper. She looked at him for approval and support for her work. "You've done a wonderful job," Johnson told her. I'm Mario Ritter, Jr.
Joins me now to talk more about that education report. Welcome, Mario.
Thank you, Ashley. It's good to be here.
This week's education report was about a program from a group based in Washington, D.C., that aims to get more Black men involved in preschool education. Government numbers show that the percentage of Black male elementary and preschool teachers is under 1%. I was wondering if you could talk a bit more about one word we heard in this story, recruit.
Sure, Ashley. Recruit is most often used to refer to getting young people to join the military or a large business. Young people are recruited to join a big organization. People who actively try to get young people to join are called recruiters. The idea behind the word itself is that an organization is reinforcing or even regrowing itself with new people. The term is commonly used as both a noun and a verb. While the activity of recruitment is part of the military and business culture, people also can use the term figuratively to describe getting a person to join any group or even to just complete a chore.
All right, Mario. Thank you so much for explaining that word, and thank you for that report.
It's nice to talk with you as always, Ashley, and good luck.
My name is Anna Mateo.
My name is Andrew Smith.
And I'm Faith Perlow.
You're listening to The Lesson of the Day on the Learning English Podcast. Welcome to the part of the show where we help you do more with our series, Let's Learn English. This series shows Anna Mateo in her work and life in Washington, D.C.
In a recent podcast, we talked about Lesson 44 of the series, where Anna says she's fighting with herself about whether to buy junk food or healthy food.
I'm hungry. When I'm hungry, I only want to eat junk food. But I know I should eat healthy food. So I fight with myself One side says, you should eat healthy food. The other side says, but I want to eat junk food.
In today's lesson, we are going to teach vocabulary you can use to talk more about this subject.
Let's start with this idea that Anna is fighting with herself. We call this an internal conflict because it's a conflict within one's self. Or we can just say that a person feels conflicted.
And notice the different pronunciation between the noun conflict and the adjective conflicted. We stress the first syllable in the noun conflict, and we stress the second syllable in the adjective conflicted.
And we can also use the expression torn between to describe an internal conflict. Anna is torn between buying junk food and buying healthy food.
And notice how Andrew used a verb with ing after the word between. We can be torn between two choices, or torn between doing two things.
So, Faith, here's a question for you. When you feel torn between two choices, how do you decide what to do?
Well, I listen to my gut, my tummy. When you listen to your gut, you listen to your instincts or your inner thoughts, right? So that's what I do. I listen to my inner thoughts. I listen to my gut. And usually my first instinct is the right one.
I think that is a good idea because you're listening to your feelings and your feelings will usually give you a good answer. You can also listen to your stomach when you're hungry.
Yes. Which is what is happening now. Anna is torn between two things because she is tempted to buy junk food, even though she knows healthy food is better. The verb tempt means to try to get someone to choose something. And sometimes that thing might not be very good for you.
And the noun form of this word is temptation. So, Faith, is there any kind of junk food that you are tempted to buy when you go to the store?
You have a lot of questions for me today, Andrew. I'm always tempted to buy chips. I have a love for crunchy and salty things, hence my love of popcorn. But sometimes I want something even saltier, like potato chips or tortilla chips. How about you?
Oh, yes, I'm tempted to buy some junk food or some snack food. For me, I think it's more on the sweet side. I'm tempted to buy muffins, which are like little cakes, and donuts and cookies. You get the idea. And even though I do get tempted to buy donuts, I'm pretty good about not buying them.
But they do taste good.
True. And they are a part of Anna's internal conflict. Let's listen.
I smell fresh bread. I love the smells of a bakery.
Oh, Anna, let's buy a fresh loaf of whole wheat organic bread.
You don't have to buy bread. Buy some donuts, Anna.
You mustn't buy donuts. They are only fat and sugar.
Exactly. You know, you are really no fun at all.
And you must think having high cholesterol is fun.
Everyone likes donuts. That is why you don't have friends.
And that is why your cholesterol is so high.
My cholesterol is none of your business.
And I have lots of friends. No!
Stop it! Stop it! Stop it! I am sick and tired of the both of you!
Notice that the word smell can be both a verb and a noun.
I smell fresh bread. I love the smells of a bakery.
Andrew, now I get to ask you a question. What food do you love the smell of?
Ooh, I love the smell of lots of things. I also love the smell of baking bread, of baking chicken, of curry sauce, and of flavored coffee. Lots of things. Oh, and I love the smell of fresh donuts, too.
Me too. Me too. We should explain that donuts are round sweet breads and cakes with a little hole in them, shaped like a wheel, or without holes and filled with cream or something sweet.
But what about donuts and cholesterol?
And you must think having high cholesterol is fun!
Everyone likes donuts. That is why you don't have friends!
And that is why your cholesterol is so high!
That's more technical. Cholesterol is similar to fat and is made in an organ in the body called the liver. Your body needs cholesterol, but some doctors think too much of it can cause heart problems.
I have one more food question. Anna's healthy voice wants her to buy organic bread. What does organic mean?
In the United States, organic means food that has been grown without using chemicals to kill insects or harmful plants. Many people think organic food is healthier, but it is usually more expensive.
So that means they might feel torn between saving money and buying something they think is healthier.
Exactly. Both are tempting.
We have one more expression to talk about today. Anna's internal conflict becomes so bad that she finally says,
"Stop it! Stop it! Stop it! I am sick and tired of the both of you!"
If you are sick and tired of something, that means you really dislike it and don't want to experience it anymore. We often use this expression to describe behavior or the way other people act that we don't like.
And notice the preposition of at the end of the expression. Anna is sick and tired of the two voices in her head. And because of is a preposition, we can again use a verb with ing after it.
Right. Like, I can say, I'm sick and tired of listening to that person complain. Or, I'm sick and tired of arguing with you.
But Faith, I hope you're not sick and tired of speaking with me.
I could never be sick and tired of speaking with you, Andrew. You're so fun to talk with.
Oh, well, that's very nice. Thank you. That makes me feel good. And we hope you've enjoyed the lesson of the day on the Learning English podcast.
Remember that you can also find us on YouTube, Facebook, and Instagram. And thanks for listening. I'm Faith Perlow.
And I'm Andrew Smith.
That's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter Jr.